Hello everybody, and a very, very warm welcome for another session on Physio TV. We have been talking on propagation of physiotherapy education for across the masses and making all of our physiotherapists aware on the concept of the domains on physiotherapy care. So today we are going to talk in terms of a very special topic, and that is on the aspect of community physiotherapy in India and management of the burden of disability. I am Apurva Shimpi. So when we are talking in the domains of the burden of disease or the burden of disability in India, we as a community physiotherapist play a very important role. India is a developing nation, and we are already fighting with the burden of disability in terms of healthcare and the cost associated with it. The government and the private sector is extremely involved in the diagnosis and treatment process, but there is a very less attention given to the prevention of disease or disability. As physiotherapists, we are partners in healthcare, but there is a very limited domain that is done for persons with disability. So what do we do in community physiotherapy? As I said earlier, in India, we are in need of a cost-effective preventive strategy to deal with the health problems and burdens of disability associated with it. As a physiotherapist, we are involved with a profession that ensures better and faster recovery of the persons with disability. And we are, in community physiotherapy, we are a specialized population who caters to a better and faster recovery of the community. Unfortunately, community physiotherapy is not a very sought out specialization in India. And as physiotherapists, we tend to be more involved with institutional domain rather than management of a community health domain. There are researches which have shown that community physiotherapists they require an adequate motivation, knowledge, and skill. And they are not very huge in number, especially in the field of community health. And hence, identification of these areas are very, very important. As community physiotherapists, we are immensely involved in prevention and treatment of public health conditions, in improving awareness, as well as preventing the problems or healthcare domains from occurring also. So what do we do as community physiotherapists? We are involved with preventing deformity disability. We are involved in investigation of CBR services, promoting self-care or direct care, promoting health and disease prevention. We are team leaders and managers. We are involved in consultation, advice, and support or on the other healthcare domains. We are involved with education and training of disabilities, transfer of skills, advocation of disabled population and local communities, curative and rehabilitative services. So hence, as physiotherapists, we are master trainers for the community. We are involved in multitude of domains, from conception of life to the graceful old age, from promoting of health to restoring function. We are involved in making our clients productive and an acceptable part of the society, because just survival is not enough. With this, I would like to introduce today's talk on burden of disability in India. We are extremely privileged to have with us Dr. Vimal Telang ma'am. Dr. Vimal Telang ma'am is former head of physiotherapy at All India Institute of Physiotherapy, Physical Medicine and Rehab, Mumbai. She has been a PG teacher and guide under MUHS and a very, very popular teacher amongst all her students. She has fellowship in UNDP from Indonesia and WHO bi-regional training in CBR in Sri Lanka. Ma'am has been involved in multiple projects with WHO and DST with the government of India. And she also has numerous publications in international peer-reviewed journals and in WHO training manuals. Ma'am is a proud owner or proud recipient of the Kanchan Kochhar Scholarship and Best Paper Awards at SIPCON and IIP. With this, I hand over the session for today to Dr. Vimal Telang. Ma'am, the stage is all yours.
Thank you so much, Apurva. Thank you for the introduction. It is, I would say, a privilege and an honor that you have invited me for speak on this subject, a subject of something which is very close to my heart. And as you mentioned, community physiotherapists require the motivation. So I'm all motivated for community physiotherapy. And with physiotherapy, your physio TV, I think you all are doing a great job as far as the propagation and of physiotherapy education and keeping up with the standards.
Thank you
so much for inviting me. I'll just share my screen. Yeah. So we have, as Apurva said, the burden of visibility in India for us as physiotherapists. We have our national and international laws and covenants on for the persons with disabilities. We have the Rights of the Persons with Disabilities Act for India. We have the World Program of Action concerning the disabled person. We have the United Nations covenant and the Sustainable Development Goals. I would like to thank, acknowledge Physio TV as well as the staff of Sancheti College of Physiotherapy. Now, the objectives of this talk today would be to understand what is the concept of burden of disease, how do we take DALYs as a metric, the need for uniformity of statistical information on disability, what is the status of disability in India? I mean, in turn, the burden of disability and the impact of COVID-19 on the disability burden. Now, when we talk of health from birth to death, we all know the definition of WHO as being a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, and not just merely absence of disease of infirmity. Through the days, through the years, WHO has not really changed, but they have given their different viewpoints that it is a resource for everyday life. And that's what we do as physiotherapists. As Apurva said, that we are doing a lot of preventive care, we are doing a lot of health related, keeping ourselves healthy. And health is a positive concept. So when we are keeping healthy, it is a very, very positive concept. And what the Lancet said in 2009 is quite appropriate in today's setting in the last year and a half, is the ability of the body to adapt to new threats and infirmities. So when we are talking of health, we are talking disease on one side and we are talking of health on one side. And when we are talking of disease, we as physiotherapists, we are talking more of the non-fatal outcomes, that is the causing the disability. Now, what is the burden of disease as per the definition? It is a gap between what is the deficit between the current health status as it is and an ideal situation where everyone lives into old age free of disease and disability. Now, we have to assess how much is the burden. How do we estimate the burden? And the third is, we should have a common measure to estimate the burden for all regions, all conditions, and the gender. Now, as I mentioned earlier, is that disability is, you have mortality as against the non-fatal outcome. Once there is a mortality on one side where it is like the job, it is over now. But what remains out of non-fatal outcomes is the disability which we manage, which is very complex, which is dynamic in nature, it is multidimensional, and it is most contested. So for us as physiotherapists, burden of disease as a health condition, it is not just that, it is the burden of impairments which we have to look after, and we have to look at the burden of activity limitations and the participation. Now, this global burden of disease study was started way back in 1990 by WHO, when they thought that we should be able to measure with a common metric. And it is a very systematic and scientific effort to quantify the magnitude of the health loss from diseases, injuries, and risks by age, gender and population over time about the fatal and non-fatal outcomes, both regionally and globally. And the whole goal was for an evidence-based policy decisions on population health so that governments can take appropriate policy decisions. And the metric they used was the DALI. The DALI meaning the disability adjusted life years. Chris Murray and Andrew Lopez were the forerunners in this study. And the global burden of disease study has evolved from 1990 to 2018 from diseases which were just 107 to 333. The risk factors changing from, the risk factors changing from 10 to 84, geographical spread from 8 regions to 774. So it has really evolved through the years. Now, what I said earlier was a common metric by which we can estimate the burden of disease is the disability adjusted life years. Now, what is this? This is a time-based measure. It is a time-based measure which is common across all regions to assess the burden of disease. Now, what is this time? So one DALI is one lost year of healthy life. So when you lose one year of healthy life, it is equivalent to one DALI. And DALI is equivalent to, DALI is equivalent to years lived with disability, that is YLD, plus the years of life loss. So suppose a person is having a healthy life and comes across some, is afflicted by some disease, then this is the, and it is, non-fatal condition, then up to death, this is the years lived with disability, followed by if there is a premature death than the expected life years, that is the YLL, that is the years life lost. So that is, how do you estimate YLD, that is the years of lived with disability, is the mathematical formula is I multiplied by DW, that is the disability weight, multiplied by average duration until remission or death. Okay, nowadays they use prevalence also. And for years of life lost, is that N into, N is the number of deaths, and L1 is the standard life expectancy at the age of death. Now, as I mentioned, the disability weight. Now, we are, as physiotherapists, we come across mostly is that is the non-fatal outcome which we have to look after. So, what is the, so when we are talking about the YLD, I said that it is I multiplied by DW, that is the disability weight. Now, each condition has a disability weight which has been estimated and put forward by WHO. So we have the disability weights, like for the first ever stroke cases is, now disability weights range from 0, that is a state of full health, to 1, which is death. So the range is only 0 to 1. So when we see the first ever stroke, the disability weight is as high as 0.92, whereas osteoarthritis hip or knee is 0.12. So we have these different disability weights. Now, just to give you an example, suppose a person has a normal life up to 25 years and then is affected with a spinal cord injury and he lives up to the age of 60 years or 65 years. He is living with a disability with the spinal cord injury for 40 years. Then we saw that the YLD, that is the disability weight for spinal cord injury, was 0.725 multiplied by the years lived with disability is 40. So for this particular person, his YLD, that means he has lost 29 years of healthy life. And then we have somebody with a normal lifespan of 30, normal life of 60 years, has a stroke, and the YLD, the YLD is 0.92 multiplied by 5. That means he has lived only for 5 years, after which he has there is a fatality, and his number of years with just 5 years, it is almost the rest of his life has been years lived with disability, lost life of healthy years. It's 4.6 years. Now, person with afflicted due to polio. Polio afflicted in age somewhere around 1 year of life. And the disability he had lived up to 80 years. Then 0.4 disability weight multiplied by 80 is 32 years of life lost. So this tells you the extent of disability that each person goes through his lifespan in case there is a health condition. Now the coverage of disability in various senses. If we want to know the burden of disease, we have to know the number of persons. So that to know the number of persons, now what was being done is generally is the census. What we do, take the census figure. Actually, census data in India started way back in 1872 and went on till 1931 when it was abandoned because basically at that time leprosy was very much in the air and then people were not reporting. It was so the estimates were much lower than what was the actual figure. So people were not reporting things like or any disability because it was like a mark on the family. So they never used to report it. So then they abandoned it in 1931 and restarted it in 1981 during the International Year of Disabled Persons. Again, there only three disabilities were being, types of disabilities were counted, the totally blind, deaf, and orthopedically handicapped. And then in 2001, we had 5 disabilities which were being counted. And since 2001, we had 8 disabilities. So we have grown through the years. The counting has improved, but we have still many lacunes. Census 2011, what does it say? That the persons with disability in India is 2.68 crores. That is 2.21% of the population. I know it has grown. In 2021 census is still awaited. Now, if we see this 2011 census, what we see, what is important for us to know is that the maximum distribution of disabled persons in India at that point of time was 10 to 19 years. Now, as Apurva said, that this has a big economic burden because these are the ones who are in the working stage, who are going to go into the, going to add to the economy, those who are going to bring a livelihood to the family. So this is a big, and the same people now have now grown up to 20, after 10 years, so they've come into 29 years in the 2021 population. So again, it is a big cost on the economy. And as you see that most of them are even the 40 to 49. So we have a big chunk of people who are in this age group, which is going to affect the family economics as well as the country's economics. There was a good study, a systematic review done in India regarding the prevalence of disability and its association with socio-demographic factors and quality of life in India. Now, it's very interesting to see that how the prevalence changes, it has changed over different studies. Now, eight studies were done by studying the impairments, enumerating impairments, and the prevalence was from 1.6% to 43.3%. So see the range. Now, which do we take it? Which figure do we take as authentic? Activity limitation, 13 studies, the prevalence ranged from 4.8% to 87.5%. When participation restriction was taken, and this was done only in a group of persons aged 65 years, it was 57%. And then all three components, that means the impairment, activity limitation, and participation restriction was measured. In two studies, it was 70% and 93.2%. And when quality of life was measured in 7 studies, the poor quality of life was maximum with 41.1% in a study. So we see that there are variables across various studies which has caused this big range of the results which we have got. Now, what could be the variables across these studies? Was the age group, of course. Then the type of survey which was used, type of scale which was used. Each one used a different scale. First is that they checked different like impairment, some did activity limitation, participation. And within each of that, they have used a different scale. Then, of course, the socio-demographic factors, which is a very important aspect, and the accuracy of measuring. Now, there's another very interesting study, which was done by the United Nations in November 2006. This was done by the United Nations Disability Statistics Database, DISTAT. And if you see that, if you see, these are the various countries, what you see on the x-axis. And this is the prevalence of disability on the y-axis. Now, countries like Australia and New Zealand, which are on economically on a much higher scale, they have a disability almost touching 20%. Whereas we know, as we see, Pakistan having something just around 1%. Why am I saying this? Because disability and poverty are interlinked. This is a known factor, disability and poverty. So it looks like Pakistan, or for that matter, Bangladesh, or having the socioeconomic factors are much lesser, having a much lesser disability percentage than the higher ones. Not that, and then again, Singapore, it is even less. Now, Singapore also falls into countries like Australia and New Zealand also has. So why is this big change? Is that non-comparable standards in the measurement and collection of disability data. So one can't compare across nations. So we cannot have a global policy or comparison within between countries. Keeping this in mind, now we have the Agenda for Sustainable Development. This is a World Program of Action for 2030. And this is a UN flagship report on disability and development 2018, in which the goal 17, there are various goals, in which the goal 17, which asks for partnership for goals, it highlights the need to significantly increase the availability of high quality, timely, and disaggregated data by disability, as one of the major requirements to monitor progress made for persons with disability. So since we want to have something standard across all nations, and therefore the Washington Group and the International Labour Organization have developed this disability module under the United Nations, and all countries are supposed to follow this Washington Group module for estimation of disability. So they have various sections which has been now approved. It was validity of and the reliability of this was done across various nations, and now it has been put forward to the United Nations for all countries to follow these norms, what we call the proformas which they have developed. Now the national 76th round of the national sample survey done between July 2018 and December 2018, in the absence of 2021 census, I'm referring to the National Sample Survey. Now, this is again done by the Government of India under Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. They have done a survey of 5,76,569. Now, what is important is that the National Sample Survey has followed this, have taken some of the guidelines, majority of the guidelines of the Washington Group when they are estimating the disability. Now, what they have found is that the person with any type of disability is 2.2%, including rural and urban. Of course, in the rural, it is slightly higher. It is 2.3%, whereas in the urban, it is 2%. But it is almost what we saw in the census of 2011. Now, what we see further in this survey is that persons having disability since birth That means onset of disability at childhood or in the first few years of life, birth, they are including almost 1 year of life, is 28.3%, much, almost one third, almost of the of the persons with disability are. Now, when here the persons are disability, it is something which is a more visible disability and which is more noted and which people are finding problems with. So, in fact, it will be, if we take from our point of view, this will be much higher. So 28.3% of the population have a disability since birth. So if we are looking at the years lived with disability, so you just imagine the amount of dallies that that person has to. It is a multiplication factor, especially if we have children with cerebral palsy, we have children with developmental defect, development disorders, as well as the birth disorders. And then we have, how many have availed of the government benefits? Government has given out certain social schemes and benefits, out of which a person having a disability certificate, only 28.8% have availed of this benefit. That means either the people are not aware of it or we are not able to reach them. These are the two possible reasons. We have to find out what is it that if we have to bridge everyone to avail of the benefits, what should we be doing? Then the literacy rate, it's only almost 50% of the person have a literacy for persons aged 7 and above. But more important than this is that those who have completed, only 19.3% of the people have completed the secondary level and above. So these are not very good figures. So these figures, we require to know this burden because so that appropriate policies and steps can be taken. Again, disability assistance, this is also through the National Sample Survey figures, is that aid or help received from the government, any help, it means any health benefit or any social schemes, is that only 21.8% have received any benefit. And from the NGOs or from non-governmental sectors, only 1.8%. So just see the health gap or just see the burden. Those who have not assessed, those have not accessed any of these facilities. Now the global tally change. It has changed from 1990 to 2019. Of course, with all the health measures and with all the developments in healthcare which have taken place and the awareness on health, the global tallies have reduced from 1990 to 2019. As far as India is concerned, we generally take one of the metrics for health is the life expectancy. So life expectancy has increased in 2016 for both males and females, and we all know that there is a change from the communicable to the non-communicable disorders. Now, as I was mentioning again, the years of life lived with disability by cause. So these are the non-fatal outcomes. So we see that most of them are where we can intervene. So the number, it is going in a descending order. So what do we see? Is that where we are involved are the low back pain, sense organ diseases, low back pain and neck pain, skin diseases, musculoskeletal, COPD, diabetes, neonatal, osteoarthritis. So most of these are the disorders where we as physiotherapists can intervene and we make a difference. So if the years of life lived with disability, if we can reduce the disability weight, that means we can really reduce the number of the healthy years, we can improve on the healthy years. Years of life lost, again, here is where our preventive measures. So we see that stroke, suicide, COPD, lower respiratory, road injuries, neonatal preterm. So we as a profession make a big difference to the DALYS outcome. Now, there is again in India, there's, as I mentioned, we have changed from communicable to non-communicable disorders. And so, therefore, our burden will change from years of life lost due to premature death to years of life lived with disability. So, India in 1990 was 10 to 14%, the YLD, years of life lived with disability. This color coding is for 10 to 14 of the for number of years YLD. And in 2019, we have gone up to 30 to 34% of YLD. These are figures from the Global Burden of Disease study. So we have a big role to play as physiotherapists to look after this big burden of YLD. We in ICF talk so much of the contextual factor, and we are aware of how the contextual factors make a big life in the participation. So BOD is the burden of disease that could be avoided by modifying the environment. This is also done by WHO study from the Global Health Observatory. Now you can see that the DALYs due in India, this is the 2012 figures, was, I can't even articulate the amount, but I can only say this is 9-digit number, like your telephone number. This is a 9-digit, whereas Australia has a 6-digit burden of disease, and the United States of America has an 8-digit. So you imagine the amount of burden of disease caused by the environment. So how do we, now these are the different causes for the environment. Now, where is it that we can intervene? We can intervene at the built environment, we can intervene at the occupational risk, and we can intervene at the individual behaviors as a profession. But on an individual basis, we do make a difference to all these factors. Now, how do we maintain capacity over the life course? Now, if you see these, this is our lifespan and how our functional capacity changes over the years. Now, what we realize is that, and we all know that, that with the contextual factor or the environment, making a change in the environment can change the disability threshold. So if you can change the disability, can raise the disability threshold, so making changes in the environment is a very, so the burden of disease due to the environment includes not just architecture, but our attitudinal, the health infrastructure, the professionals, all that will make a difference in the disability threshold. And then while we were all rejoicing that we are, our health parameters are improving, comes this great COVID-19 along with our already existing burden of disability and making it, and with the poverty and inequality adding to it, we have this syndemic. So how is the impact of the pandemic on the burden of disease? What has happened is that we already had, we all know that how persons with already pre-existing morbidities were more prone to mortality and affection. So we had COVID and COVID mortality plus morbidity plus the socioeconomic impact of the lockdown. What has happened? We have had an increasing non-communicable disorder burden. So the burden has only increased. This is very interesting. Dr. Richard Horton, the editor-in-chief of The Lancet, what has he to say? That COVID-19 is an acute on chronic health emergency. And non-communicable diseases have played a critical role in driving the more than 1 million deaths caused by COVID-19 to date. And this is the mortality which has been caused because on an existing non-communicable disease background. India COVID, now these are big figures. Now this is up to September, end of September, which I have referred to, what is important again, that non-fatal, why we are talking about fatality, and we are very happy with that, that our fatality rate is very low. But what we have to look at the non-fatal COVID, and we know what are the morbidity, what are the, what is the disability left by the non-fatal COVID. So we have a, this is just the head count. If this is the head count, so just imagine the dallies. 33 million and above is the head count for the non-fatal COVID just in India. Now, again, this study has been done in India about the crisis, and out of what they have reported, that among the 5 lakh COVID-19 cases reported till the end of June 20, more than 70% were linked to comorbidities like the diabetes, hypertension, and heart disease. So this non-communicable disease becomes a very important, what we call a fertile ground for other conditions to come and take over. So that's what WHO said, the Lancet said, that what I said earlier, that our ability to face the threats. The impact of COVID-19 infection on life expectancy, premature mortality in Maharashtra, what have they found in Maharashtra? That there has been 1.6 million additional years of life lost in the state, and Delhi due to COVID-19 has to be estimated to be 6 per 1,000. So imagine 6 per 1,000 is what is estimated. And I think this is still a very low, it is an underestimated figure. So what was the failure? Is the failure of prevention of the, again, we are talking about the non-communicable, I'm talking of the non-communicable disease, because most of them have been, the fatality has been because of the non-communicable disease, persons with non-communicable disease. The overburdened health system and an unacceptable high loss of life. So this pandemic becomes a watershed moment for all of us, all persons with the healthcare system, as well as the public at large, for health emergency preparedness and investment in critical 21st century public services. So here is where our community service, physiotherapy in community services, will make a big difference. So the disability burden, if I say more than the head count, we could say it is the unmet needs, or what are the participation restrictions. So the contextual factors are the biggest barrier. So we have to look after these contextual factors. Of course, health awareness and health promotion is very, very, very important. But once a person has, once a person is afflicted, these contextual factors make a big difference. So changes in the environment, changes in attitudes, changes in healthcare, all will make a big difference to taking out the unmet, reducing the unmet needs and improving the participation restriction. So managing the burden of disability, as I mentioned, is it is being multidimensional, requires a multi-pronged approach. So we require health promotion and disease prevention, we require restoration of function, we have changes in government policies, we require mobility aids and appliances, manpower, we require many more people at the community level, as well as people who are managing at in their individual disciplines. We require a big factor on the changing the contextual factors. So what is our goal? Our goal as physiotherapists is converting an individual dysfunction to function at the level of the organ, the person, and the environment, for him or her to participate with equal opportunity in the community. Thank you all. Thank you very much again for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I mean, this was really very elaborate, and we could actually understand the impact of not just what disability has caused an entire burden on our society, but also how COVID-19 has added to this level of disability. My one question is, how do we assess these environmental factors when we are talking in terms of the burden of disability, and how do we apply this evaluation or knowledge that we have got from this?
Actually, application of the, as I mentioned in that Washington group, one of the questionnaires has some extent on the environmental factors. But the environment, of course, there is a government policies are most important. One is from, of course, we all know about the architectural barriers which each one of us faces, the normal as well as the persons with disability. So, of course, there are a lot of policies being done in the new constructions and all. But simple things like having even crossing the road, if you have the footpaths, having a small ramp near the signal, as you see some of the Western countries, where the person can easily, our footpaths itself are so high, so just getting off the footpath becomes difficult. And most important is, I feel, the attitudinal barriers. Attitudinal barriers, we don't talk of attitudinal barriers for the person with disability. I think the attitudinal barriers as far as we as healthcare professionals also. So very often I feel we become more barriers when we look at it from, again, I always come to the thing of felt needs and the assessed needs. So we have to find out, when we are talking about contextual factors, we always have to look at the person's felt needs. So what is the person that he needs? What are his participation restrictions? Very often we go by what are our assessed needs. We know that he has done, we are looking at changing the timed up and go test from 8 seconds. Now we want to go from 10 seconds, we want to bring it to less than 10 seconds. But for that person, does that 10 or 8 really make a difference? Of course, we have to do it. But we have to see from point of view of how it will make a difference in his participation restriction. Simple example I very often give this example is that we are looking at changing the spasticity from a grade 3, 2 or a 1. And we are happy that, he has improved. But our assessment should go towards the patient's health need. So it is very often our assessments, from when I'm talking about changing in attitudes of for healthcare professionals, we have to change our assessment procedures. We should not just look at so we have to see more from a patient-centric. Our assessment tools should be more a patient-centric than an impairment-centric. So that is our attitude in changing our assessment tools. So once we change our assessment tools, I'm sure we can find out many more contextual factors. And contextual factors that everyone knows are very individualistic changes. So the disease may be common, but the participation restriction may change in different individuals just because of the contextual factor. So architectural and attitudinal, even our aids and appliances. So we have to find out whatever we are intervening, is it going to be a barrier or is it going to be a facilitator? So simple things like what we are giving as an aid, appliance, are we giving it more like a gift, what we normally used to, are we just giving it as a gift and the person, or is it going to be functional? So finally, we have to convert the dysfunction to function. And as far as assessment of all these contextual factors, in fact, that is one big a problem which we are going to face if we are going to quantify that, because it is going to change across all regions, regionally as well as individually.
Right.
And socioeconomic becomes a very, very important contextual factor. The economic, because very the poverty and disability are, it is like a vicious cycle. So changing the social structure, changing the economic structure, all that. So even as I said, that accessibility to education, accessibility for jobs, accessibility to access healthcare facilities. So, going into the community, how much it is sometimes because a person may be, even a person one does not have to be in a rural area to actually access health care. In a city like Mumbai or in Pune also, a person staying on a top floor and cannot come by the lift, he is cannot access healthcare services just because he cannot come down the stairs. So, and then to hire somebody coming home is very expensive. So it your person has to live the life with disability. So YLD just keeps increasing.
So essentially, ma'am, what we are saying is the performance-based measures are more important to be assessed rather than the physiological-based measures.
Exactly.
Okay. And how do we use these tools? For example, when you're talking of assessment of disability, we are still using the mode or the guidelines which are given in the gazette by the government of India. But globally, for example, now tools like the WHO DAS are being used. How they differ when we are talking of evaluation of the disability, and do they quantify this burden more better than what tools we are using in our country?
Yeah, I think they will quantify tools better because then it is more function based.
Right.
So it is more function based. So when they are measuring disability, it is what they call is that benchmark disability. So I don't know whether we can take that benchmark disability. For us as physios, any dysfunction is a disability when we talk from an ICF point of view.
Right.
So a person with a backache may not have a benchmark disability of 40%, but that person may not be able to function at all.
True.
You know, so then it is these people who get lost, who are not counted. And counting all of these, then it is actually the burden, as I mentioned earlier, the burden of disease is much more than because we are seeing more of benchmark disability. So the benchmark disabilities for those people then, because more policies and all are made for the benchmark disabilities. So for the others, we are talking there, that is the place where we come in health promotion and restoration of function. So performance-based measures for us as physiotherapists, when we are seeing our patient, becomes a very important part of our therapeutic regime.
So ma'am, how do we as physiotherapists advocate for these clients or these persons with disability as far as their health or functioning is concerned?
See, for persons with disabilities, this is something which we always said that when we look at a person with disability, is that we are looking at only his disability, the cause of his disability. For example, a person with a residual poliomyelitis or a person with a stroke. We are looking only at the stroke or we are looking only at the polio or the residual. But remember, a person with disability can also get a cough, can get a cold, can get fever, can get yes. tuberculosis, can get blood pressure, can get diabetes. So health promotion of these persons, and we leave them so these factors are left out because nobody wants to look at, because very often what happens is that when a person, like for a person with stroke, they get something, they just, okay, it is like they are just sidelined, you know, and then very often they say you go to a physiotherapist. And this is where our preventive aspects for the non-communicable disease and the health promotion is a very important part. And very often these people do not do, more often than not, they are not doing any fitness. Right. All this, we are, in fact, all of their cardiac function is very low. We had done a study on this a bit long back on children with adolescents with cerebral palsy, is that we found that the 6-minute test was not, their cardiac parameters changed within the 6 minutes. So their cardiac functions, all these can are important. So we have to look at the non-communicable disorders which can affect these persons with disabilities.
Sure.
So we have to look at, so in the community, we have lots of disabled persons, even if we look at the benchmark disability. You know, unfortunately, they are not, because they are not a vote bank. So they do not come into public unless they are only used when it comes to distribution of aids and appliances. so that it makes an impact. But nothing as far as, and again, when we are distributing aids and appliances, how many really require it, how many do is not looked after. So it is just an assist. There are so many people, give it to them.
Right. So ma'am, with your last interaction with you, we are now actually taking up a study where we are evaluating the impact on these persons with disabilities post the COVID lockdown era. So how has it further deteriorated or worked out? So would you like to give any inputs or suggestions to our audiences as how, from a physiotherapist perspective, we should change our outlook in this post-COVID era towards our clients or patients with disabilities also?
See, as I mentioned, that what was said in the by Lancet, that we have to be ready for any threats.
Hmm.
So it was like a threat. COVID was like a big threat, which we were not, it was like a landfall where we were not ready.
Yes.
So we have to, so our health promotion has to be there. So to prevent any future threats, we don't know what type of threat it is going to be. Right. So, but we have to keep our health fitness, whether the person is any individual who is living, meaning I'm talking in spite of them, those non-fatal outcomes, has to keep the health fitness, and where we will make a very, very important role in the community for fitness. So I think that, and so when we are doing an organized and a scientific method of fitness, where we are keeping all the parameters, we are monitoring the parameters and doing it, I think we should do a lot of awareness campaign on health fitness, how physiotherapists are involved in health fitness and prevention of disease.
Right. So very soon, I believe in December, we are going to celebrate the Day for Persons with Disabilities.
December 3rd. Think,
yeah, it's a request from all of us that as physiotherapists, again, it's an appeal to all the viewers from Physio TV, be involved with awareness, propagation, preventive dimensions, or as ma'am is saying, how we can make their quality of life and functioning better. So that can be a small contribution from all of us as professionals in this particular field. So on behalf of Sancheti College of Physiotherapy and Physio TV, I would really like to thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation and giving such a wonderful insight on aspect of disability and our role in this. So thank you once again for this beautiful talk.
Thank you so much, Apurva. Thank you to Sancheti College and Physio TV again. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure.
My pleasure, ma'am. Thank you. And we sign off for Physio TV. Have a wonderful day ahead. Thank you and take care.